It may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
What a way to start a Tuesday morning with a leap of leopards. Now, there's one in the tree, there's one on the ground next to us, and I'm sure there's a third somewhere close by. This is Safari Live. We're with the royal family. They are still in the same place, so it doesn't look like Hyena found their kill yesterday. I was trying to see if they might have put it in the tree, but I can't see just yet. Isn't that gorgeous? Which way to go down? Which way to go down? That way. Let's go see if I can pounce on a sibling, I think might be the next play. I can only see one of the royal cubs, but I'm sure the other is close by, and that was Karula we had lying next to us. Look at that, just disappearing into that long grass. Oh, there comes Karula. Now, isn't this an absolutely fantastic way to start the day? Now, my name is Brent Leo Smith. I have Batman on camera, and remember, hashtag Safari Live if you've got any questions for us. So there we go. Oh, let's do that. I didn't see where Karula went. She went to the base of the tree where the kill was yesterday, and no sign of Hosana at the moment. He could be around somewhere. Oh, I'm just going to be on the radio for a second. Morning, Tax. Karula, my Bimpa, in the same place. FM, make your way, I'm the only station. Ah, there's Karula. Or was that Hosana? There she goes. Steph's wondering, what meal did Karula get for the cubs yesterday? It was a young impala. I think it's finished. They're moving off now. So we got you in the nick of time. Now, where are they off to? They could be taking us on quite an adventure if they head that way today. Ah, there's Hosana. He's just made an appearance. It looks like he's still got some meat in his mouth. So all three present and accounted for. Where'd Hosana go? They just keep disappearing into this grass. There he is. He's got a little tasty titbit that he's taking with him. I think that's probably all that's left of that impala. Xongile is right in front of us, and so is Karula. Good morning, Stanley. Stanley's wondering if the light bothers animals. Well, as you can see, it doesn't. They're completely ignoring the light. Now, you must remember their eyes work very differently to ours, so they are not bothered by the light. What have you got there? Crunch, crunch, crunch. Now, I've lost sight of Xongile. Can only see Hosana and Karula. That's Karula right next to us there. I'm just using it. Oh, the grass is so long. It's an interesting morning. We're worried about rain. It was very dark and ominous to the south. But we are still sitting in a lot of mist at the moment. Hopefully the rain stays away for the safari. It's about 24 degrees Celsius, around the early 70s Fahrenheit. Now, Michael, you're spot on, correct. Karula is definitely getting older. And Michael likes to know how long till she uses her strength. Leopardesses can hang around for a bit. And I know of a female who got to 19 years old. But it is unusual. I would say she's probably maybe got one more litter of cubs after Hosana and Xongile. So probably around 14, 15 will be sort of when she starts dropping condition. At the moment, she's in very good health for a leopard of her age. All her teeth are still good. And so hopefully she lasts for longer than we all expect. There's Hosana and his tasty treat. And I think they might have killed a scrub hare or something else last night as well. Oh, where's the little Xongalolo gone? She's around here somewhere. And while we stick with the leopards, see where they head next, what they get up to, let's go to Jamie, who's with the animals that give the leopards a hard time.
Fortunately, not giving the leopards a hard time at the moment, and even more fortunately, they are home. But a very good morning to all of you, and welcome to our sunrise safari. My name is Jamie. This morning, Dave is on camera with me, and we are sitting at the hyena den in the dark, because I slightly overestimated how much light we were going to have at this point of the day. I thought the skies were gold. Obviously, I can't illuminate the den, so I'm afraid you're going to have to make do with a rather patchy view for now, until the sun comes up a little more. You can just make out a cub. There we go. Hello, little monster. How are you? So, my dire predictions that the hyenas might have moved their den in all the rain have proved to be incorrect, and Ribbon is still here with her two little cubs. A relief to all of us concerned. And two little cubs settling down for breakfast. We've been trying to visit them each and every single day. Sometimes they're not home, or at least Ribbon's not home, and so the cubs are hidden in their den site. And don't forget, while we're sitting here with these wonderful predators, Brent's got his own wonderful predators, to send through your questions using the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Dave, while it is dark, I am contemplating a move. The problem with that is that if we move, Ribbon likes to come and lie here, right here. So if I move, it might make our lives more difficult. But those cubs are suckling now. What to do, what to do? I'm gonna try a move. Let's see, we can always go forward a little bit. They're not even moving now. That's so cool. Oh, Sandy, very valid point, because Brent has just answered why he can use a spotlight on the cubs now, the leopard cubs, and you want to know why we can't use a spotlight on these little guys. And it's actually purely a matter of age. Dave, if I stop there, how's that? That's great. That's wonderful. Look how curious they are. Sandy, it's just because they are so young. These cubs are only probably about 5, maybe 6 weeks old now. They're just starting to get the whites around the eyes, so I'd put them at about 5 or so weeks. And that is really far too young to have a spotlight on it. Just basically it adds an extra level of distraction if they're not used to it. Bear in mind that they're tiny, their little brains are quite small still and developing and they're learning. Hey cuties! Which means that that extra level of stimulation might actually prove too distracting if a predator were to come through. And we've had lions walk into hyena den sightings, we've had wild dogs walk into hyena den sightings. If I was sitting spotlighting them, illuminating them, first of all, it'll draw attention to them, and second of all, it could actually distract them to the point that they don't see the predator because they're not used to it. They're just too young to have that extra level of stimulation. And also it's just overpressurization on a den site. If I were to sit here with my lights blazing, Ribbon might decide, actually, you know what, this isn't such a good location after all. I think I'm going to take my babies elsewhere. And we don't want that either. Though it's just a sign of respect. Karula's cubs are now over a year old. They've learnt, and their reflexes in this... oh no, come on. Isn't that just too precious? They've learned, they can multitask, essentially, far better than our hyena cubs can. These two are just too small. Good morning to Dominique. I'm using mom as a jungle gym there. Dominique, you want to know what age hyenas develop their full set of teeth? They're actually born with a fully erupted set of milk teeth. Obviously that's not their full permanent teeth. I think that they have their full adult teeth by a year and a half, but it'll start at around about 6 months of age that their permanent teeth will start to grow. And I suspect that it's similar to... Oh, that is so sweet. Having bath time. Uh-oh! Somebody tumbled down. I suspect that it is the canine incisors, similar to leopard cubs or to wild dog pups. There was such a look of adoration there from that little hyena cub. Hello, you almost ready to come up and say hello to us now. Oh, Rachel, while we watch our little cubs get bolder and bolder, you want to know if they will ever venture out while mom is not home. Yes, as they get older they will. At the moment though, they're still too small to do that. They might stick their heads out of the den if something comes past. We've seen them do that with us. But they won't come out. And that's just pure instinct there. That tells them that they need to stay in while they are at such a vulnerable age. But they will start to venture out by the time they're 6 months of age. Often we've paid visits to hyena dens without any mums, and the spotted little surprises are gambling about all on their own. But that's, again, when their senses are slightly better developed and they know that their reaction times are fast enough to get them back in the den site itself. But you can see they're still a little bit wobbly. And be a very poor idea indeed if they were to wander out and a predator happened to come wandering through, because they're just not very fast, not very coordinated, and all in all, not ready to face the big wide world just yet. Lisa, I don't know how they know to stay put. I have seen when mothers get up and walk away, often the hyena cubs will try and follow her. And we've often witnessed frustrating but hilarious battles between mothers and their cubs, carrying one back and putting it in the den, and then another one pops out its head, and then she has to go and get that one, and then the other ones come out again. So we have witnessed some hilarious scenes while the mothers try to get them into the den itself. But I think once mom is gone, I guess it must be a natural instinct and fear to stay hidden. It'll take them a while to overcome that fear of the big wide world. There's an elephant somewhere not far from where we are. I heard it crack a branch, which would explain the lack of hyena tracks at the entrance. It was because an elephant walked on top of them. And good morning to Hunter. No, Ribbon didn't dig this natal den, and we'll go into a bit more detail in a moment, but this was the very first den I ever visited when I started working at Safari Live. It was back when Bella and June and Gwen's cubs were still tiny, tiny. June was this size when I started working here in 2015. So hyenas regularly reuse den sites. Usually what they'll do is they'll take over an old warthog burrow or an old aardvark burrow. Oh, testing out those sharp needle teeth. And what will happen is, if it's collapsed, as this one had, the hyenas will have their cubs, and the cubs will actually excavate the tunnels inside themselves. They make little cavities where only they can fit in, and other larger animals can't. Ah, nice. All right, let's go and see if that hyena managed to reach those leopards.
Well, look at this. We've got a hyena, Xongile, and Karula. Oh, the hyena's just walking away. Well, that was a bit of an anticlimax there, Xongile. She doesn't look perturbed at all about the hyena. Karula gave the hyena a bit of a hiss. But I think the hyena might think they've got a killer around here. I think you're too late, Howard. There's Karula. Hosana is coming up behind us somewhere. And you can see now, the cubs are quite adept at dealing with hyenas. They know exactly what to do, and they're way too fast for a hyena to get them. You can see how Xongile is watching where that hyena walked off to. Oh, it's coming back. It's got its own kill here, the hyena. Because that isn't an impala, or is it? So there we go. Look at that, isn't that incredible? The hyena had stashed some meat in the water. Now it's worried the leopards are going to steal it. Off it goes. So hyenas often stash kills in water where other hyenas can't smell them. AFM tax, the hyena had its own yama here. So here we go. Oh, now they're off to go investigate. Oh, Hosana's going to go have a look where the hyena was stashing it. No, it wasn't her nyama. So it was much older than the kill that they had. So there's a deep pool over there that the hyena had stashed that meat in. And there you go, Xongile. And Hosana's right next to us having a drink. Xongile is going to investigate. We can't really see her, but we can't really go but further forward here. Is going to investigate, and Karula's also investigating where that hyena had that kill. What, are you going to go put your feet in the water, silly? Yeah, no, no jumping across water for Hosana. He's just going to walk through it. Rachel's saying she had no idea that hyenas stash kills. Well, they do that, and they generally, if there's water around, they will use water, and that's to prevent other hyenas from stealing it or smelling it. But now, I've crossed this little stream. Here comes Karula back towards us. She went to investigate if there was any free meal there. So leopards are not above scavenging, and they will happily steal if they can. Oh, thirsty Hosana. Now I'm just going to try to see if there's a spot where I can get across here. M. Ruth says the scavenger got scavenged. Well, nearly. Sorry, guys. I'm just trying to see if there's a spot where I can safely cross. It looks like I can. So I know you're going to get left behind again. Okay, let's make sure. Just want to make sure there's no big holes here that we're going to slide down into. Now, when it comes to crossing things like this, the angle of your crossing is very important. There we go. No soft sand. Haven't lost. Uh-oh, that's what I was worried about. distance. As I said, the angle's very important, so I'm just gonna have to put myself through the trees. Oh, hold on. There we go. Oh dear. We trapped ourselves. There's another big hole in front of us. Oh dear. How bad's that hole look, Craig? Can you see? Oh dear. That is quite a large hole. Plan B. Oh. We've got ourselves in a bit of a predicament, but we should be able to make enough space by just pushing that dead tree that's been pushed over by elephants. Hold on! Hopefully not get too many thorns. Craig, watch that hole for me. Are we good? Oh, nearly lost my earpiece to the thorn tree. Thorny thorns. Now it's trying to find them again. So eyes up. See, just that, whatever it cost us, about a minute, and she's vanished. So the general line was through here. Batman, wear your infrared goggles. Rex, did you see how far they went? They could still obviously be behind us. Okay, well, I'll try to find the royal family again. Let's go say good morning to Stef. Yeah, Rex.
Good morning, good morning. Thank you very much, Brent. And it is a good morning, a misty morning in actual fact, with the local herd of Impala here at the quarantine open areas. My name is Stefan Winterboer, and yes, you're on the bushwalk with us this morning and looking forward to it. I must be honest, a lot of moisture in the air this morning. It is humid, so humid it feels like you can spoon the air into your mouth this morning, and that's going to have an effect on what we see definitely throughout the course of the morning. Normally things sort of taper off towards the end of drive as it gets hotter and animals start to go to the shade or start moving off to water sources. When it's overcast and misty like it is today, animals tend to move for a lot longer of the time. Now already we've got something that's unusual on quarantine open airs. We've got a herd of zebra, or as some would say, a dazzle of zebra. For those of you who are interested in the collective nouns of animals, right there on the middle of the open area, silhouetted nicely against the clouds, are a fairly large herd of zebra for this particular area. Now the reason for that is that zebra are grass eaters primarily, and there's much better grass fields to the east of where we are right now in the Greater Kruger National Park. We're situated on the western fringe of the Greater Kruger National Park in a private game reserve called the Sabi Sand and in an even smaller portion of privately owned land within that reserve called Djuma Private Game Reserve. All one continuous piece of land, 8.5 million acres of wilderness area for these animals to walk around in. And so it is easy for animals to walk to places where the food is good for them. And in this particular case, in the Sabi Sands, large herds of wildebeest, large herds of zebra do not really occur here. You get your odd herd coming through here, but what you just witnessed over there with that herd was something pretty special. Now, why is that the case? Why would we have all of a sudden, out of the middle of nowhere, a herd of zebra arrive? For a couple of reasons, in actual fact. Excuse me, I've really, the flies are buzzing around my head with a frenzy today. A couple of reasons, in fact. One is that this time of the year, the grass has finished flowering in most cases, even finished dropping its seed in other cases, and then the grass gets lignified. What that means is that the grass basically becomes unpalatable. It becomes so hard and so full of nasty sort of compounds that animals can't really digest it anymore. And so they start moving to areas where the grass is better. Now, in this particular area, we had very early rains, which was very good. And then we had virtually no rain in the middle of our summer. And we've had good late rains. And so some of the grasses here have flowered late, comparatively speaking, to the areas around us. And I personally think that's why we're going to be seeing a few more dazzles of zebra like that, and maybe a couple of other rare things, perhaps an ostrich or two, maybe even some large herds of wildebeest, and of course the ever-present large herds of buffalo, which draw in the lion towards the end of the dry season. And there's just the backsides of these zebra going into the distance there. You can see they're keeping a fairly healthy, look, one having a bit of an argument with another one there. They're cantankerous things, zebra. Now, what you're witnessing over there is just this, they've stopped now because this is the distance that they are comfortable with us at. When we were a little bit closer than that, they were moving off, and now that they've created some distance, they've stopped and are looking at the bush in front of them. Being high up on lion's food menu, they won't want to just wildly run into the bush without being able to see or listen first. And so this, we won't push them much more than what we're doing at the moment. What we will do is run the risk of pushing them into something in front there. And I don't want to have the effect on something being eaten just because we want to see them closer. Now, Liz, you've asked me if we're going to be seeing more zebra due to the rains. I think so. I think basically because this area is going to have a sort of flush of grass a little bit later than areas adjacent to us at the moment, I think we are likely to see more zebra. It's always a difficult thing to say, you know. These animals, okay, I'll finish that question when you come back to me, Liz. We're quickly going to send you over to Brent, who's got some hyena that are back with those leopards.
Well, we've got a hyena that's come back. I think this is a different one. Hosana is probably 4 meters from him. It almost looks like he wants to jump on the hyena. The hyena hasn't spotted him. Oh, now he has. No, Hosana's gone flat. The hyena definitely didn't spot Hosana. Now, I don't know where Karula and Xongile are. I think that hyena is really worried that someone's going to steal his piece of meat. It could be the same one that didn't get a good enough look. Maybe Hassan is tracking, thinking if he can steal that piece of meat and go up a tree. Cedar Point is wondering, will leopards hesitate to fight hyenas? They will. Big males, really big males, like Tingana, will often give hyena a good hiding. It definitely looked like Hassan is trying to find where that hyena's ditched the carcass. Checking under all the bushes. Now, I'm sure Karula and Xongile are close by. Hey, mister. Oh, he's getting so big. it is even possible that Karula and Xongile could still be behind us, because we lost sight of them and we only spotted, well, Batman spotted Hosana moving through. This is quite a common route for them. They come down through the drainage onto the edge of the seep line here and head south. Oh, hello Karula. She just popped up right next to us, right next to us, about a foot from us, and Xongile is on her way as well. So we've got all three of them. There's the queen herself, and Xongile is coming past the vehicle now. Hello. Now, wouldn't it be fun if they stole that hyena's carcass and took it up a tree? Once it's up the tree, there's not much Howard can do. Now, I know everyone's saying Howard. So Howard is my nickname for all hyenas, male or female. And it's after a life-size cardboard cutout of a hyena that we used on a film shoot some time ago. And it was from one of my photographs and it became Howard. And since then, all Howards are hyenas and all hyenas are Howard. So, speaking of Howards, while we follow the royal family, we look to be tracking Howard. Let's go to another group of Howards. I suppose it's a bit like the Bruce Australians. All Howards are hyenas, so let's go back to the den.
One Howard and two mini Howards are enjoying their morning snooze. The two mini Howards, also known as hyena cubs, are suckling from their mother Ribbon, aka Howard. Sorry, I'm just turning Brent's game drive voice down. He's busy talking to some of the other guides about the leopard sighting. And you can see, we've settled in for a peaceful morning suckling, although it took Ribbon a while to get them to that point. They were chewing on each other's ears, dragging each other around by their loose skin. I've just noticed you can actually see spots on them now. And they might actually be a little bit older than we originally thought, because I can see spots on their lower legs. Okay, well, you can't really see now. You might just be able to see with the one's elbow. I think that they might actually be a little bit older than we originally thought, but they are still utterly adorable. I have one very interesting question. You want to know, how do you compare a mother hyena with a mother leopard? I suppose it's apples and oranges, really. It's a completely different reproductive strategy. Leopards do have den sites, but generally not in termite mounds. And of course, for them, raising their offspring is an entirely solitary affair. Whereas for hyenas, although the cubs are the responsibility of the mothers and they don't allosuckle, it is a sort of a communal thing. The fact that the entire clan is devoted to defending this territory, the weight doesn't rest upon one female's shoulders. And generally you'll find that hyenas have a slightly higher success rate with raising their offspring than leopards. And that's not because they're better mothers, it's not because leopards are worse mothers, it's just one of those facts of life. It's the way that they've evolved their social structure, and the fact actually that they leave their cubs so long in the den sites. And it's one of the reasons, no, let me rephrase that, it's one of the theories behind why the females have such high levels of, have evolved to have such high levels of androgen, where they're basically larger than the males and stronger than the males. And it's called the Big Mother Theory. And the Big Mother Theory is basically that testosterone is a hormone, testosterone androgen, hormones that will actually allow something to bulk up, you know, think potentially female athletes on steroids kind of a deal. And the bigger you are, the more food you get, the more food you get, the bigger you are. And the more milk you can produce, and the better you can protect your cubs. And they actually tend to have a little bit of a higher success rate. But it's just the way that things have evolved out here. And of course, it helps that they're in the scale of the predator hierarchy. They're pretty high up there. I mean, if you get a large pack of wild dogs, of course, we've seen them pick on hyenas before. But really, when a hyena clan gathers together, they are relatively evenly matched between wild dogs and hyenas and only really sit below lions in the predator hierarchy, whereas leopards are almost at the bottom of that large predator hierarchy, topped only really, or bottomed only by cheetah, who are slightly less robust. So it's just a different, completely different strategy. Karula has to do everything on her own. She has to hunt on her own, she has to defend her territory on her own, and she has to feed the cubs all on her own. Which means that she's got to leave them in places, as she does. And Karula's been successful, but other female leopards might not share her success. Whereas a hyena, if it needs food, if it's hungry, the other hyenas, if they find a buffalo carcass, I mean, apart from when they stash it in water, in the same way Brent's one has done, they will often call together and call other members of the clan with their excited giggles and whoops. So again, just also better access to food as well. Ribbon likes to come and visit us in camp, don't you, Ribbon? Yes. You and Taylor had a long conversation. It was so funny. She was reaching towards the bin. It was an empty bin, but it was a bin outside. And she'd reach, stretch out her head towards it, and then Taylor would talk sternly to her, and the head would go back again, and she'd retreat a few steps. And then Taylor would continue talking to her, and she'd walk a little bit closer and stretch out in slow motion, try and stretch her head back towards the bin to sniff it. Hey, naughty girl. Yes. You were very brazen. Melissa, you want to know how large the clan is at Djuma? I would say we're probably over 15 now. Would that be right? Let me just do a quick count in my head. Because some of them, I think some of the sub-adults, there's a chance they might start dispersing at some point. But we've got Madam, Pretty, Corky, Gwen, Scarback, and Ribbon as the current breeding females. That's six. Did I miss anyone out? Madam, Pretty, Corky, Scarback, Gwen, Ribbon. And then we've got about four clan males that we regularly see, so that's 10. And then we've got a host of sub-adults. So Bella, I haven't seen June in a while, unfortunately. It's been quite a while since we've seen June. But we've got Bella, we've got D1 and D2. We haven't seen November, I don't think, for a while. We've seen January, the January twins. So we're looking at around about 15, maybe just over 15 with the sub-adults. But some of them may start to disperse. Especially the males. They could stick around and become clan males, but they could also become nomadic. We still don't know, and unfortunately we'll never know, I don't think, which hyena was killed by the Nkuhumas a couple of weeks ago. It happened on Simbombili, and unfortunately we weren't there to witness it. It was apparently a sub-adult, but we don't know which one it was. It might have been from the EP clan, it might have been from our clan. We're uncertain. We probably won't ever know, sadly, because it's not as though if we don't see a hyena from the clan, we can immediately conclude that it was killed, because they do wander off, and we don't always get to reconnect with the cubs that we've watched grow up. Which I suppose is the perennial sadness of these live safaris, even with leopard cubs, when they grow up and disperse. Colleen in Texas, welcome and good morning. Colleen, you want to know if hyenas will bring back food to the den site to help the mothers. They won't bring back... you know what? If you read some textbooks, they say that they won't bring back food at all, which is utter nonsense because we've definitely seen them do that regularly. And it just goes to show that you can't always take research on hyena at face value because they behave differently in different parts of Africa. High-ranking females are generally the ones that drag food back to the den. If there are other high-ranking females around, a low-ranking female probably won't. But I wouldn't put it past Gwen if she's denning on her own somewhere to do it as well. But generally it's the high-ranking females that will drag back food to the den. Apparently Brent suggested that the hyena might be bringing the carcass back towards the den site itself, the hyena that he saw earlier. I would hesitate. Let's see. I don't think so, though. I think Comet's going to go and sit and consume it somewhere else. But we'll see. But no, they won't bring back food for the mother. So we've been talking about how leopards and hyenas compare. Now let's compare wild dogs and hyenas, where a female wild dog who has mated and has had pups, and it could be the alpha, it could also be the beta. It's not always just the alpha that breeds. But a female wild dog, the rest of the pack will go out hunting and they will often bring food back for her. And then as the pups get older, they might leave a babysitter behind. And again, the wild dogs will return and regurgitate food for the adult and the pups at the den site. So wild dogs are sort of the epitome of a true team. Hyenas, they work together as a clan, but it's a little bit more every hyena for his or herself. Particularly for the lower ranking females and the males, of course. I'm going to sit here patiently because once these hyena cubs have finished their food, I'm hoping they're going to be full of beans and not go straight to sleep. Let's head out with Stef on foot.
You find me on top of a termite mound that I like to visit from time to time. And it's only because you've been having such wonderful sightings with both Jamie and Brent this morning, with those hyena and the baby hyena and the leopard and the hyena interaction, really quite cool. But there are some crowned plover, crowned lapwing, that have been making alarm calls the whole time we've been here this morning. And I just wanted to stick my head up over the top of this termite mound to see if we could actually see what they're doing without scaring them away. But I think I've managed. So there one flies over there, and I managed to scare it away anyway. That is the crowned lapwing that you may have just caught the flash of the white wing bars. But what it does do is it gives me an opportunity to finish off my question, or my answer to Liz's question, which was, if it rains here some more, can we expect to see any more zebra? Or because of the rain that we've had late in the season, now this last weekend, which has filled up all these dams so nicely, are we likely to see more zebra? And Liz, I would like to say yes, I think we are going to be seeing more zebra. I think it was about 3 weeks ago now, I went just east of where we are now to Sotara, one of the rest camps in the Kruger National Park, and the grass was literally this high. The elephant, an elephant bull, was wading through the sea of grass where the grass was at their armpits on his front legs. It was truly a phenomenal sight. But that grass would have lignified right now. It would have become hard. It's tall. It's difficult to see through. And the nutritional value is starting to retract. And I think what we're seeing here is like a mini migration away from areas that got good rain, but early in the season, towards areas that got good rain now, later in the season, where the grasses are still going to be much more palatable, much better grasses for these particular animals. And so I would like to predict that we probably see a few more zebra and a few more wildebeest herds coming through here. I don't know if they're going to stay. But what we might start to see again is buffalo herds. It's something that we haven't seen for a long time now, is any herds of buffalo. I actually can't remember the last time we did see a herd of buffalo, Brian. Nothing.
Lately there's been three.
Three herds of buffalo.
No, three.
Oh, three buffalo, yes. There's only been three buffalo lately. They've been hanging around Chele Pan, but we haven't seen buffalo herds, and it's because they've been able to move out of this area, move into areas with much better grass cover, and they will eventually come back. I have no doubt of them coming back. So hopefully that answered your question, Liz. It's all got to do with grass, and it's got to do with rainfall patterns, and this particular year, more so than I've ever actually remembered. But that doesn't say very much with my holy memory that I have at the moment, is the fact that we've had very isolated or localized thunder showers that have poured down an incredible amount of rain in a very small place. I mean, just take Saturday, for example. Nkoro, which is on the other side of Cheetah Plains, which is how far? 3 kilometers from here, 1 mile, or just over 1.5 miles from here, not even 2 miles from here, had double the amount of rain that we had here. And 60 miles away from here, where I live and spent the weekend, we had no rain whatsoever. We had 5 millimeters, which is nothing. So difficult to say, you know, what effect this is going to have. The grass cover is still sparse. Come and have a look here, a little bit closer to the ground. Even though from the corner, from an angle, you can see a lot of grass, you're not seeing a lot of grass cover. So just what I'm trying to draw your eye towards is the fact that you've got a sea of grass out there, but you don't really have a lot of grass cover, and this is a direct result of that drought. Grass hasn't managed to spread. What we should be seeing is a mat of grass if it was a good rainfall year. a mat of grass, which we're not. And so I don't know, what does this mean? October will tell us. Take a screenshot now, right there, bang, and we will see exactly what this looks like in October. I predict a very sandy October, probably similar to what we had last year myself, actually. All right, now I can answer David's question, who asked, why do termite mounds not wash away when it rains? David, they do actually wash away when it rains, except for where they've been baked hard by the sun. So if a termite mound reaches a certain height at nighttime, for instance, or they have had a lot of interruptions to their building, and you've got these spikes in these chimneys out there that are quite thin and haven't been built on, quite often the rain will wash it away. But where the sun has baked that termite mound hard, in other words, where it's been allowed to have water basically wash off the side, bakes hard, wash the side away and bake hard again, it turns into a cement that you can dig through. I mean, aardvark and dig through it, pangolin can dig through it. You can with a sharp stick dig into the side of it, but it literally turns into a low-grade cement, which is virtually impervious to water and to the elements. A hard rain will wash some of it away, but you know, the fact that some of these termite mounds are 200, 300, 400 years old and have been in the same place is just testimony to the fact that the type of cement that they have is evolved to cope with the erosion that happens from, and the weathering that happens from the elements out here. All right, we are going to carry on walking down there, and we are, in the meantime, going to send you over to Jamie, who's still sitting with us, our hyena.
The hyena cubs that are being so incredibly sweet. One is finished with its breakfast for the morning and is now lying on its back, legs in the air, trying to snap at flies that are hanging around mum. Oh, we're up again. Is it time to try and go for some more breakfast, or are you just going to climb on mum? Not very successfully, I might add. Oh, shame, and the fly's biting you, little one. They're all stable flies. And I know exactly what that feels like. It's so itchy when they initially bite you. Shame. Michael, you want to know if they're old enough now to properly determine the sexes. It is a tricky, tricky thing. You have to really closely examine their genitals, ideally when they're interacting with each other, because that's when you can see them slightly more clearly. Particularly, look, you can see the little spots. Particularly when they're interacting with other members of the clan, so that you have a chance to see exactly the rough shape of the genitals themselves. Yes, they're old enough to try and determine. However, we could so easily make a mistake that I'm hesitant to do it. I really am. You can also watch their behavior towards each other. And so far, they're sort of playing with each other. The one on top seems to be slightly more dominant than the one below. But to be completely honest with you, it's such a risk. And as we've recently seen, sometimes a case of mistaken hyena sexing does occur. Ask Ribbon all about it. Roll over. You just want to go and rub that stomach. Not that I ever would, of course, because I actually quite like having all my fingers. I prefer not to have them chomped by a little hyena cub. So I'm hesitant to try and sex them right now. And good morning to Kate, who would like to know, how many cubs does a hyena usually have? Maximum two, quite often one, but generally we've seen that they seem to be able to produce two healthy cubs within this clan. It depends. Oh, getting so brave. Oh, that was very Cape Townian. Getting so brave, wandering out into the grasses. I don't know where that came from. It depends very much. I think actually a lot of the time when we see just one hyena cub, it's because the second has died during the birthing process, because it's actually really difficult for a female hyena to give birth. And often for first-time mothers, they don't manage it. It's quite common for them to lose both cubs during the labor process, because it just takes too long with their somewhat modified genitalia. Look at you. You're so cute. But Usually you see hyena cubs with two. They have two nipples and therefore accommodate two cubs. There's also, I'm not going to go into great depth, we've spoken about it quite a lot, but there's also an idea that's been put forward that originally basically came from one article, that siblicide is exceptionally common in hyenas, and that if two cubs are born of the same sex, they will kill each other before one of them will kill the other before they come out of the den. There's a lot of researchers that are now pushing to actually disprove that it's as common as we think. I'm sure it does happen, but it's relatively uncommon. It's also relatively common for hyenas to... Not relatively common, sorry. It also does occur that other members, other females of a hyena clan could kill the cubs of another one, particularly a low-ranking female, if they get to be overly rough with their own cubs. Pink patches of skin on its armpits. At least they no longer look like hairless cats, which they did initially. They were very bald when we first saw them. You can see the spots nicely. You can really see their spots coming through. Ouch, someone's complaining. Ouch, ouch, ouch. See, already, we've seen some serious hyena fights before. Already that instinct is there. Go for the bottom and the ears. And that's how hyenas fight each other. Nips to the bottom and grabbing onto each other's ears. And when I last had a proper look at Ribbon, she had quite a nasty, deep bite just behind her tail. And she hasn't got up so that I can actually see whether or not it's looking any better. Michelle, you want to know if hyenas are related to canines at all? Canids, actually. The answer to that is probably if you go back far enough, you'll find that almost all mammal species have some kind of a common ancestor, or one or two common ancestors, but that's really far back. They're actually more closely related, evolutionary-wise, to things like mongoose. Things like mongoose and badgers. And that's due to the anal gland that they have, a very highly developed anal gland that is not nearly as well developed in things like cats and dogs. So they're not part of the dog family, they're not part of the cat family. Apparently, if you go back far, they might be more related to the cat family than the dog family. But either way, it just makes more sense to actually think of them as something completely separate. They belong in their own family, the hyena days. The hyena days! That's what we would call our soapy if we were to follow our soap opera. If we were to follow these hyenas all day, every day, we call the hyena days. Clonk! Onto its head. They look very dog-like though, which is why there's a very common misconception that they're basically dogs. And they're definitely not. Okay, I'm going to sit here and wait for these cubs to get brave, which I think they're going to. Let's go back from the Hyena Day family to the Feeder Day family.
There we go, here comes. Oh, that was a bit weak. He got caught and decided to give up. And it looks like the clouds breaking up. It was mostly mist this morning, so we're in for a sunny day. Karula has gone to sleep in a tree, probably about 100 meters from here, after growling at the cubs, telling them to stay put. And Xongile is keeping herself entertained with grass, and Hosana with just watching her. Anna would like to know, do I think Hosana weighs as much as Karula? I would say probably even a bit more already. So most definitely as much, if not more, than she does. Oh, here we go. That was pretty. Can you hear the hissing? Xongile not impressed with Hosana. Maybe she might come have a drink. Oh, frog! It looked like an African bullfrog that just leapt into the pan there. That confused her a little bit. Now the patience game, see if the frog pops its head up. Sid would like to know, how do we tell the difference between the different leopards? Well, one of the first things we look at is where we find them, from where their home ranges and territories are. Between Hosana and Xongile, it's very easy. He's more than double her size already. These guys are, what is it now? A year and 2 months old. Bless you. And other than that, they definitely have different body shapes, different colorations, but the best way to actually tell the difference, and the one that's most commonly used, is a spot pattern. Let me just see if I've got a, there we go, picture of, actually while she, oh no, turn your head back towards us. No, she doesn't want to. But the last line of spots above her whiskers is a unique as your fingerprint is. So especially if you don't see a leopard too often, the way we identify them is from that last line of spots above the whiskers. There we go, you can see she's actually got five, or was that just a bit of wet, four on the left. Oh, is Hosana going to decide to come barreling in again? Sam's wondering, when they get older, do siblings mate? It is possible. Big cats are well-known inbreeders, but generally they don't have any genetic effect for up to about 3 or 4 generations of inbreeding. But normally the young males disperse far enough away that they never rate with aunties, mothers, and sisters, but it does happen from time to time that they will inbreed. Oh, Hosana is up. He's that busy body, isn't he? Now Claire's wondering, do leopards have any predators? Yes, they do. Hyenas will kill leopards, lions will kill leopards, wild dogs will kill leopards, leopards will kill leopards. So when cubs are under a year old, their mortality rate in this area is about 75% to 80%. And out of the known mortalities, 75% of that are perpetrated by other male leopards. Specifically nomadic males, so males between the age of 3 and 6 that are still searching for their own territory, are the biggest killers of other leopards. Well, it's all still a bit quiet here. We're not going to go anywhere just yet. See if they get up and moving again. While we do that, it seems like Stef is following some feathered friends.
We are following somewhere. We're not really following some feathered friends, rather than having bumped into them. And here we have at least three species. Yeah, three species as far as I can see. Birds in one tree. And they're in this tree for a very specific reason. With the wet weather that we've been having recently, and also the very humid night, these birds would have become quite saturated last night. And what they're waiting for is the sun. The sun is starting to burn the mist off behind us and is now letting those trees, there we go, you can have a look at the sun coming through the mist. It's still a bit of patchy cloud. I'd say it's probably about a 10% covering of clouds at the moment, of thick clouds, which is going to keep the heat at least down a bit. But there you can almost see the orb of the sun. Oh, burnt that into my retina now. Every time I blink, I can see three or four suns there. But these birds are now just waiting in the tree to catch the first rays of the sun so that they can dry themselves out a little bit. And there's a very specific reason for that. And that to stay warm, birds are warm-blooded, and to stay warm, they're going to be using metabolic energy, energy stored up from the food that they've been eating. This is not good for their weight. They would have dropped weight keeping warm. And birds that are too light don't have the energy to fly and find food. Birds that are too heavy won't take off and become lethargic and will stay in one place, which is dangerous because you get preyed upon. So birds have to operate in a very narrow weight band. They're like super athletes that can only really operate in a very specific weight band. You're just too slow, or you don't have enough energy, or you don't have enough stamina when you're too light, and when you're too heavy, you're too lethargic, and you don't really want to go anywhere. And birds are very, very sensitive to that, in particular the birds of prey. So birds of prey like falcons and eagles and hawks and whatever else they're around at the moment, will only operate when they are at the perfect weight, and it's literally within a couple of grams of one another. Now, keeping warm obviously saps energy. It then uses weight to keep warm. They would have been low energy there, and so these birds would quickly need to warm up and dry out before they start feeding for the day. Now, what we have over there on the top left-hand side, right at the top, is a Burchell starling. In the middle is another Burchell starling. On the far right-hand side, we have a dove, a turtleneck dove that has just flown off, and there were four or five yellow-billed hornbills, southern yellow-billed hornbills, in the tree as well, but they've moved off now, luckily, leaving us over here, wanting to know where else to go. Now, we've decided that we're going to be going to quite a special place today. We decided to go north from the camp. Now, going north from the camp is a signal nightmare for us, except when we take the long way around and we end up on the crest close to Tambwati Dam. So that is what we're going to head to now. We're going to head to Tambwati Dam. There's a bunch of rocky outcrops there I haven't visited for at least 6 months, and I'm hoping that we get some nice end of summer plant communities and some insects and some other interesting things to show you. That's the plan anyway. In the meantime, we're going to send you off to Jamie, who's still at that hyena den.
Sounds like Stef has a wonderful plan for your morning ahead. We're still with our hyena cubs, and I have some good news to tell you. We are well on our way in our habituation process. I moved the vehicle to see that if they decided to become a little bit bolder, we'd be able to see them on this pathway. And they didn't stir at all when I moved the car. They didn't even stir when I accidentally hooted. It was a total mistake. I didn't mean to. I just bopped. I didn't even know Jigger's hooter worked. I just bopped it with my knee, and they just looked at me. So they've very, very much become accustomed to our presence and are not bothered by us in the slightest. I immediately looked across at them in horror, in case I'd sent them scurrying back into the den site. Riven's ear didn't even twitch, did it, Dave? And the two cubs looked at me briefly and then carried on what they were doing. Now, I think it's safe to say they are no longer afraid of us. I was just saying, we need some older hyena cubs to come and teach these little ones to be brave. You always find that when you've got older hyena cubs at a den site, that they tend to egg on their smaller cousins, or the smaller cubs there, into being a little bit braver than they might otherwise. And watch the way these two interact. As soon as one goes, the other one becomes slightly braver as well. No, don't go that way. I moved here so that you wouldn't. Little nonsense. Now, Dominique, you want to know if our baby hyena make a noise? Yes, they do. I've even heard them at this age whooping. It was the cutest thing I think I've ever seen or heard. It was November at the Gallego Shortcut Den. Look at this. Come on. You can be brave. It's okay. It's okay. Imitating the other hyena whoops. Whoop. 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 It was adorable. I don't know if anybody's got any footage of that somewhere. but that was truly extraordinary. And they also beg and squeal. They make high-pitched squealing noises, or squeeing, as it's known, begging for food and complaining when mom won't feed them. And the occasional high-pitched squeal when the teeth get a little bit too sharp and the bites get a little bit too sore. So they do make a noise. Spotted hyenas are very vocal, and that's apparent from a very early age. Anna, you want to know why do hyena produce milk of such high fat content? And it's an interesting sort of connection between why female hyenas are so much larger. They do have some of the richest milk of any mammals out here. It's some of the best milk available. And Anna, the theory is that that is why female hyenas evolved with such high levels of male hormones. It's the big mother theory. The bigger you are, the better milk you can produce, the faster and stronger your offspring grow. And they also have quite an extended lactation period, and sometimes recorded lactating for up to a year and a half whilst feeding cubs, which is a very, very long time out here. When you compare it to leopards or lions, especially leopards, those cubs start to eat meat at about 2-3 months of age and are pretty much fully weaned very early on. And the same goes for lions. They might have a slightly longer lactation period, but still never a year and a half. So it's part of the connection with the fact that female hyenas are so much bigger. The bigger you are, the more food you have, the more resources you have in order to provide milk for your little ones. And it's a competitive world out there. Still not that brave. Still not going more than a few meters away from the den site. Now, James, you want to know if at this age the cub's strength is equally matched. I know what you're saying. I hear what you're saying. It depends, of course, if it's a male or a female. If it is a female cub, she will already be slightly larger than the male and slightly stronger. But obviously, there's also the fact that they just have that natural instinctive dominance. But I would say one of them is larger and is stronger than the other. That could change. Let's say they're both females, which I doubt, but let's say they're both females. That could change depending just individuals. Certain individuals grow faster than others, grow slower than others, so that could shift around a bit. But from now, I think I can see one that is slightly stronger than the other. It tends to be the one that is more aggressive, and often the one that's on top of the other hyena, shaking it by the ear, like this. So you will already be able to see a difference in the strength of them. So it's not just, and I think I know what you're asking, it's not just a product of the natural dominance of a female. There is actually a physical aspect involved as well. Ow! That looks really painful. They're such tough little creatures. Hey, Elena. It is lovely to hear you back on board with us once again. Elena, you want to know what age will they be when they start to eat solid food? Oh, there was a squeak. There was a complaint. They'll start to nibble on solid food at just a few months old, especially if their mother's brought food back from the den. I've seen a hyena cub of around 4 months nibble on an impala carcass, but not really know what to do with it. 6 months, 7 months, they'll start to properly eat solid food. But again, as we mentioned, they could continue to suckle usually about a year, but up to about a year and a half before they are fully weaned from their mothers. Now, the cubs of high-ranking females will get to chew on food from the den. For a low-ranking females that are denning with high-ranking females, she'll probably have to start taking her hyena cubs with her at a younger age. When they're at that sort of just under a year old, she'll start to take them with her to the kills. Oh! You fall down. Some squeaking happening as well. and can see that the cub at the back is... that's actually quite sore. Ouch. Will you let me go, please? But then go straight back for more. You little terror. Oh, the hyenas aren't particularly brave at this point, unless their mum were to get up and come closer to us. But it pays off, because it means they stay close to the safety of the entrances to the den. And let's say yes, there are birds of prey that would catch and kill a hyena cub. I would say it's relatively unusual, but martial eagles especially are known for catching larger prey. Oh, poor mom, look at that face. So there was a case of a martial eagle taking a wild dog pup from outside a den last year when it was wild dog breeding season. So it does happen, but I would say it's relatively unusual. And it also probably plays a factor in choosing a suitable den site. Having a little bit of cover to hide the hyena cubs when they're at this vulnerable stage. I mean, a martial eagle can take out an impala, a young impala. So a hyena cub would be absolutely no bother. And when my puppy was about this size, my Vimarana puppy, I spent my life panicking. You actually have to sort of learn to calm down and not stress about every little thing. But I spent my life, every time she went outside, staring up into the skies to make sure that there wasn't an eagle that might come down and swoop down and grab her. And it happens to people's pet dogs and cats out here regularly, and on the coast as well. Crested eagles, long crested eagles, are also quite famous for doing it. Taking people's Jack Russells and Yorkshire Terriers and so on. Anything is fair game if it's under a certain size. Fortunately, I imagine that my dog Lexi now, at 35 kilograms, will probably not be at risk any longer. Oh, Patricia, Ribbon's been very kind to us today in that she's been around, but of course the last few days she hasn't been. We want to know how often she will go out to search for food. Unless she's had a really large meal, she'll probably go out every single day, or every single night, actually, to be more specific. And we'll actually leave them in the middle of the day as well. This gets a bit much after a while. And he's clambering all over on top of her, chewing her ears. Chewing on her ears, biting her, stomping on her face. It'll get a bit much, and in the next, I would say, if I had to guess, but I mean it would just be a guess, in the next half an hour or so, she's going to get up and leave them. She'll go find a nice peaceful place somewhere in the bush to snooze the day away, and leave her cubs to nap in the den site itself. That's why it's the perfect time to come to a hyena den. First thing in the morning and in the evening, when chances are mom will be around and therefore the cubs will be out. Those back legs are getting stronger. Watching them, you can't help but really enjoy seeing how sweet these hyena cubs are. And that's one of the things we love about these live safaris, is that they certainly reform impressions about certain animals. Now, Keith, you want to know, what is the myth about hyenas scavenging all their food? They do scavenge. Male lions scavenge too. Leopards scavenge as well. It happens. And when they've got the advantage of numbers, yes, they might chase something away. And yes, they will chase leopards away from their kills if the kill is on the ground. That's just that what they're designed to do. But they are capable hunters. And the amount of scavenging versus hunting that they do depends on the area that they're in. There are certain places where spotted hyenas basically only hunt, because there aren't that many lions around to provide them with a ready source of prey, or leopards or other predators, and therefore they have to hunt, and they are more than capable of it. And they are, especially in places where you get really large clans, they hunt cooperatively to bring down their prey. They're not ambush predators. They would find it very difficult to be an ambush predator, but they do have phenomenal stamina, so they'll chase down their prey. So they are not just thieving scavengers. they will hunt for themselves as well. So that's the myth. It's also just a tendency that human beings have to make certain animals bad guys, which is totally ridiculous because all aspects of nature are not governed by the same morality that we might have or the same emotions that we might show. Hyenas will kill other predators. Other predators will always kill other predators. But somehow, with human beings, there so often has to be the bad guy. Whether it's the shark in Jaws, which of course Peter Benchley felt terrible about and did his best to contribute to shark conservation afterwards, or it's the hyenas in The Lion King. There's got to be a bad guy. But there isn't really. Now, I thought this was going to be my last few minutes spent with these hyena cubs, but to be honest, I can't tear myself away. I still want to see whether or not they're going to get a bit brave and come up to us. And we're going to sit here for a little bit longer. Let's go and see what little things Stef has found to distract you.
We have got an epic battle going on between a pirate fly and a drop-tail ant who's carrying the larvae from one nest to another. Look at that, look at that. That fly busy trying to grab the larvae away from these ants. Here's another one here. So we've got another one coming through your way. So what's happening is these ants are moving from one side to another, and these pirate flies are trying to steal the baby ants. But because they're ants, and these drop-tail ants have got quite a vicious sting, these flies are actually being super cautious. I've watched these flies throw caution to the wind with termites time and time again. But with these ants, you can just see them. Here's another one coming here. So let's just watch the larvae. It's going to be... there we go. Here comes the fly in. But the fly's careful. Didn't want to. There were too many ants around at that time. Wasn't opportunity enough. It is just insane. These flies, I've only actually just noticed them this year, in actual fact. It just, the grass cover was low enough for us to see these pirate flies for the first time in years. And it's just been amazing to watch how they parasitize termite and ant colonies. They generally grab the, there we go. Yeah, he almost got tackled from the back. Now what happens is, as soon as that ant realizes it's under attack, it sprays out a pheromone which drives the ants in the nearby vicinity into an attack frenzy. So that fly can't actually afford to be stung by these ants. It will kill it. And so it comes in, makes a go at a larvae, and as soon as it realizes it doesn't have the edge, it flies away. Attack again another day. Now these flies, what they will do is they usually just attach to the abdomen of their prey, suck it dry from the back, usually leaving it alive. There we go. Oh no, too many ants. These ants have definitely got the upper hand so far in that they are carrying one larvae at a time, and it's usually just one individual surrounded by 20 or 30 others. And so they don't overwhelm the ability. Here we've got another one coming through here. So it's coming out onto this open plain, which of course is where the flies have the advantage. So let's see if it can cross this open area without attracting too much attention. No, the fly's there. There we go. And it's alone. The ant doesn't have any. Yes, that's cool. So that ant definitely, there were three or four ants that came immediately to its rescue. And that ant is now, there we go, he's now attracted the attention of a younger fly. But that young fly is not working in the center of the open patch. He's working on the fringes, which makes maneuvering for that fly very difficult. So obviously the bigger flies are controlling the best areas and leaving the younger flies the periphery, which makes sense. And only if you are big and you are able to defend your patch can you go and hunt there. So let's see now this young fly is back in the center again. We've got another three larvae coming through here, so three. Let's see if that will work. If one, so coming straight at the fly, here we go, Fly, attack the first one. No help, no helps around. Fly's got it. Yes, got it. He just needs to be able to get a good grip and he'll actually take off carrying the larvae and the fly. Let's see. Here we go. And he grabbed it, couldn't quite get it. No, being overwhelmed. So these ants, this strategy works. There, he's got it. Ah, and the ant almost stung the fly in the face. Here's another two or three larvae coming through. Eventually they will get one. So what the fly will try and do is grab the larvae and then pick it up and fly away from the ant colony, giving a chance to suck that abdomen dry. Very, very, very cool. So why would these ants be moving? It's probably just because their tunnels are full of water with the rising water table, the rain lately. And it could also be because there's a fungal infection inside the the termite colony, or they're being preyed upon by something. Here's the colony here. You can see that they're coming out of this grass patch here. And they've moved probably about 10 meters, 10 yards, to just the other side of this grass patch, and they dug themselves in there, slightly higher ground. Could also be for food. They could also have finished the food in this particular area, and that is why they're moving. So ant colony moves from time to time. I mean, there are ants that are sedentary for a long time. I'm busy watching and have luckily been watching a ant colony close to Chelepan, a trapjaw ant colony. They haven't moved for a whole year at all, but these ones are moving, obviously. Now, Colleen, you've asked me all the way from Texas this morning, will ants sting humans and is it dangerous? Colleen, absolutely. Ants are some of the most venomous creatures on the face of the planet. In actual fact, the bullet ant holds the record for having the most painful sting of any creatures. Ants, bees and wasps are, of course, related to one another. And ants being the most sophisticated of the three, the most sophisticated and therefore would have the most sophisticated venom. Quite often it's just a type of formic acid that they can inject into you. But in the case of bullet ants, of course, and as far as I know, I'm trying to remember what in North America you have a fire ant that is the cause of a lot of discomfort on lawns in your yards. It is a fire ant, eh, Brian? Fire ant. Which infests all the, and you know, ants, just amazing things. So yes, in you know, the short answer to your question. Let's go back to this battle over here and see if the flies have managed to, excuse me, if the flies have managed to successfully drag off anything else. Jeffrey, you've asked me if the flies fight over hunting range. I actually want to answer that question with a yes, Jeffrey. Look, I haven't read anything about these particular flies' behavioral traits. I think what you're witnessing here is a very rare video record or video log of what these flies actually do. And I've never seen anything on pirate flies, and the literature that you read on them is observationally based, and is what I recite when we come down to these things. But just my observation today, why would a younger fly not dominate the central, more exposed area where hunting is better because they can maneuver? And the only conclusion that I can come up with is simply that the larger flies will chase away the smaller flies from prime hunting areas. It happens across the animal kingdom, where the biggest, most dominant animals have the prime hunting sites. And just those hyena that you're watching with Jamie, a case in point is the matriarch. She absolutely has the pick of the choicest meat, and because of that her cubs are the biggest and strongest and most robust and more likely to survive. I cannot imagine that it's any different in this particular area. Now, this is the second larvae you've watched over there make it unmolested across this open area. So I think these ants have successfully managed to actually defend their column. Unless these ants have moved off somewhere else. Let me go and see if they're not somewhere on another open area and they've decided to move off. Here we go. So I found one. So, Barbara, you asked me how long will it take the fly to die from an ant sting. probably pretty quick, Barbara. I would imagine that if it got stung, that the volume of venom that the fly, that the ant can inject into the fly would have a catastrophic effect on it. And it would also account for the fact that these flies are so nervous. You can see that that fly, very observant, just keeping a 360 view around him. Every time an ant comes close, he moves away. And so I would imagine that just by that caution, that the sting would be catastrophic to this particular fly, this particular species of fly. Overwhelming, I would imagine. So let's just see now. So we found this fly. It's another open patch. You can see it's a fairly large fly dominating the central area. Now, flies have got a compound eye. There we go. So targeted another one. Nope, too many ants around that particular larvae. Flies have got a compound eye, and the only way that I can explain it is if you can imagine having a helmet of GoPro cameras on your head. So they've got a fixed focal length. It's a very deep focal range, so everything is in focus up to a point, and they see almost 360 degrees around their head, but not very far, and they've got no ability to zoom or focus on something further away. So it's a fixed focal length, it's a deep field of focus. So everything up to a point is in focus, and then it becomes a bit of a blur. But because they can fit so many eyes onto a small space, can you imagine how many GoPros you can fit on your head? They are able to cover a much wider field of view than our more complex eyes like you and I have, which are quite complex machines. And we can't have all the muscles. We can't have 20 eyes around our head. We won't have enough space for all the muscles and the blood vessels and the nerves and everything. So definitely this column of ants, the trail of larvae that is leaving this column is definitely dried up. And I think that that is probably why these ants or these flies have moved on. They've actually followed the column to the nest to see if they can pick off any stragglers that get a little bit too far away from the main column. I can't see any more larvae coming out, so I think that's probably hunting over for this particular fly for now. Wasn't that just like the most epic thing that we've actually seen the whole day? I know for me that was sort of the highlight of this morning so far, and probably the highlight of the last couple of days worth of filming actually. Let's walk down the column a little bit, yeah? We actually saw these ants. Now here's an interesting thing. Here's a massive open area, obviously created by the road that we have. It'll be interesting to see if there's any flies here making use of the sort of barren plain, so to say. I can't see any flies, which means to me, at least anyway, that these flies are needing at least some elevated position, either to watch the colony and to approach the colony from, or as an escape route in case things do get a little bit hectic, or as a third option and probably the most likely. I have seen these flies grab larvae and the accompanying ant, and then fly onto an elevated position, which of course stops other ants from coming quickly to the rescue. So a space can be too open, is my conclusion there. And that is why we're not seeing any flies on the actual road. Let's move with the colony a little bit and see what are we seeing here and deeper in. So here the colony of ants is moving through this area here to their new home at the base of this particular grass. Let me open up for you here. So this is their new home underneath there. And you can see some ants on the way back to go and help with the move. So it's not just a one-way journey. Some ants are already on the way back. And I'll move. Now, Sarah, you've just asked, why would the fly keep coming back if it expects to die? What an interesting question there, Sarah. Simply put, it's because the fly needs to eat. So it's survival. The fly realizes that with a little bit of caution, it can extract some food resource from this particular ant colony. And because there's no other ant colonies in this particular area that are moving today, that fly's best chance of a meal is right here. Of course, that puts it in the line of fire, very similar to how a lion or a hyena, for that matter of fact, would attack a herd of buffalo, just because there's 600 head of horns over there and it provides a formidable barrier, doesn't overwhelm the need for that lion to be where the prey is and to try and single out the weakling in the herd so that it can feed on that particular buffalo. One of the roles of predators is to cut out the sick, lame, and lazy, and old, and weak. And I have no doubt that in this particular instance, we're just seeing a form of that, in that the ants carrying the larvae that are not taking caution and are traveling with their friends in the center of the colony are going to fall prey to these flies. And it's the way that these, Mother Nature just sort of makes sure that only the fittest and only the strongest survive. And that the flies, the cleverest flies, the flies that are able to make use of these, you know, parameters, they're the ones that proliferate and make cleverer flies. All right, we are finished with these flies. We're going to carry on. We are on our way to Tambuti Dam still, and hopefully some more of these exciting things to show you. And you're off to one of my colleagues. I can't remember which one.